This I call the recipient of the Georg Simon Ohm Prize to the floor, Marvin Edelmann. As I said, the prize will be awarded at other instance, and the Georg Simon Ohm Prize is meant to be awarded for research at the master level in applied physics. Let me introduce, while people come in and some strive out, Marvin to you. Okay, they are busy with the microphone. He has obtained a bachelor in physical technology at the Hochschule Göttingen, not at the university, but at the Hochschule, and switched to receive a master in engineering physics at the Hochschule Emden-Leer and the University Oldenburg. And it is this master thesis that he's going to present to us. And since 2021, he is in the graduate program in physics at the University of Hamburg and is also working at the synchrotron at the DESY lab. I believe that, Marvin, you're getting ready. Take your time. And this is also early career presentation. And I assume you are somewhat nervous.
Definitely, yeah.
We are fully entitled to, but we are kind people and we are eager to listen to you. The floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much for this very kind introduction, and thank
Let's
you all
give
for...
give him an applause.
Sure. Thank you. Again, thank you very much for joining today. It's a great pleasure to be here. I want to talk, or I present some results from my master thesis, which addresses all optical nonlinear noise suppression and mode-locked lasers, as well as ultra-fast fiber amplifiers. I want to start by acknowledging a few very important people. One of them is Professor Matthias Wollenhaupt, who was the master thesis advisor, and he had really exceptional, even during Corona times, exceptional lectures on ultra-fast optics. And second, I want to mention Professor Franz Kärtner. So most of the experimental work has been done in his laboratories. And here also now doing pursuing my PhD program together with Professor Gerd Leuchs as my second supervisor in the context of the Max Planck School of Photonics research program. Of course, special thanks are due to the DPG and to the award committee for giving me the opportunity to speak here today, as well as, of course, for the award itself, which is also kind of nice. So I want to start by explaining or give a motivation on why low noise mode lock lasers are actually quite good to have. It's essentially because they are the driving source for state-of-the-art fields in the engineering part, but also in the science. First of all, we have, of course, micromachining, as well as photonic microwave generation. Synchronization and timing in large-scale facilities such as DESY or the European XFEL, and last, nonlinear multiphoton microscopy, but also all kinds of other nonlinear effects, which are to some sort, in, yeah, let's say, intensity-dependent. Fiber laser technology have established themselves already as a reliable and high-performance laser source. And what's interesting about fiber lasers is that they have a set of very rich nonlinear dynamics, which can actually be used and tailored to build, first of all, new devices or construct, let's say, new nonlinear systems. And in this work, I want to address some of them, which we found in during my master thesis, which are, first of all, ultra-low noise fiber oscillators, especially with extremely low noise, intrinsic low noise working points. And then I also want to show how this then, the results led to the development of a fiber amplifier system, a nonlinear fiber amplifier system for standard quantum limited intensity noise suppression. But first I want to give a broader introduction. So what is the mode lock laser? So here you can see a schematic of a kind of idealized continuous wave laser. We have an optical cavity consisting of two mirrors, one of them being semi-reflective, as well as some sort of gain medium with which is able to emit photons in a certain bandwidth. Once it is pumped energetically by some pump, which could be a diode laser or a flash lamp or other sort. And as a result, the gain medium will start to emit photons which are actually trapped by the inside this optical cavity with the frequency that is restricted by the boundary conditions of this cavity. And the laser, the photons form a standing wave, which is known as longitudinal mode, which is amplified by stimulated spontaneous emission, which results in the output of a coherent laser field. So in a real world, it's not only a single longitudinal mode, but instead, for example, in the case of Titan Sapphire, one has millions of longitudinal modes coexisting in the optical cavity. However, they have a kind of arbitrary phase relation, and they constantly fluctuate with respect to each other, so they propagate mostly independent. The trick is now to obtain mode locking and to generate ultra-short laser pulses to insert a satchel absorber into this cavity, which is a device that kind of modulates the cavity loss, reduces the cavity loss proportional to the intensity. And by this trick, one can force the longitudinal modes in a state of constructive interference, which then results in the propagation of a short laser pulse, which bounces between the two cavity mirrors, and each time it hits the semi-reflective mirror, it creates an identical copy of itself, leading in the time domain to the emission of a kind of optical pulse train with a periodicity that is given by the round-trip time. In the frequency domain, accessible via Fourier transformation, one has the comp of equidistant comp lines, which are separated by the repetition rate. And 2005, it was shown by Theodor Hensch as well as John Hall that this is intrinsically a stable comp line can be used for really high-precision spectroscopic measurements. And they have in the context of optical frequency comps, which is of course very beneficial for a lot of really state-of-the-art applications. Just to name a few, would be optical atomic clocks, astrocomps for the search for extraterrestrial planets, but also of course the high intensity of the laser pulse is beneficial for a variety of fields such as attosecond science to really resolve ultra-fast dynamics. For example, of molecules. So the problem is, in those applications, while the laser sources are intrinsically low in terms of parameter fluctuations, there are certain limitations which are put on those applications originated in the noise of the mode lock laser. This noise is coupled to the optical pulse train by different sources. First of all, there are quantum fluctuations and amplified spontaneous emission, but also just environmental perturbations, such as pump instabilities or humidity drifts. And also the gain medium contributes via relaxation oscillations to the overall fluctuations of the optical pulse train. If one writes a mathematical description for such a pulse train in the time domain, one can distinguish the different noise sources. So first of all, we have the amplitude or intensity noise, which is commonly quantified with the relative intensity noise that relates the magnitude of the fluctuation to the average power of the pulse train. Then we have the timing jitter, which is a deviation from the perfect periodicity between each consecutive pulse, as well as the frequency noise, so the fluctuation of the optical carrier frequency, as well as the phase noise. So now the question is, why are fiber lasers beneficial for such low noise sources? And this is because they have, due to the fiber itself, intrinsic shielding against environmental perturbations. If one looks at really state-of-the-art mode lock laser sources, one can find, for example, fiber lasers mode lock with nonlinear interferometers. Here are two sketches or two mostly applied configurations, which is figure of 8 and figure of 9 laser. They are made of specialized polarization-maintaining fibers, which makes them really exceptionally environmentally stable with a high resilience. And this allows, for example, the application in space systems and space-borne frequency metrology, as has been shown, 2016 by Litzius and others. And Yes, as I said already, they have really a state-of-the-art noise performance among ultrafast fiberlasers in general. And in addition, of course, which is also a big factor, is they can be constructed with telecommunication certified components, which makes them, first of all, cost-efficient, but also very, gives them a long lifetime. So now the question is, if one compares those two pictures, one can see a few differences. The game medium is maybe clear where it is located, but one main question is, how is the Setcher absorber now working in such fiber lasers? And for this one has to go a little bit into nonlinear fiber optics, in particular the influence of self phase modulation on the pulse propagation in a waveguide on an optical fiber. And essentially what happens is the ultra-short laser pulse propagates, for example, in such a step index fiber and interacts nonlinearly with the material. One of the effects that arise from this nonlinear interaction is the optical care effect, so the intensity-dependent modulation of the refractive index. This results in an equally intensity-dependent modulation of the phase of the pulse. If one, for example, has a Gaussian input pulse or with Gaussian intensity distribution, one then gets an equally Gaussian shape of the self-phase modulation. If one looks at the instantaneous frequency, one can actually see that this results in a generation of new frequencies on a, on the edge and the tail of the pulse. So one can use this effect, for example, to generate really broad supercontinua or such things, for example. The good thing is, one, even though the propagation is highly nonlinear, one can very well describe them with nonlinear Schrödinger equations. So here's already the compact version. There's a, with a generalized nonlinear Schrödinger equation, one would additionally implement high-order dispersion terms as well as other nonlinear effects. What this equation enables is to simulate the, or calculate the pulse evolution in the fiber as influenced with a gain as well as loss, chromatic dispersion, and then the self-phase modulation. And this enables one to really compute and accurately simulate such fiber, not even highly nonlinear fiber systems. So back to one of those highly nonlinear fiber systems. Here we are again at the a mode-locked fiber laser. In this case, we use a fiber interferometer as artificial Setcher absorber. The fiber interferometer is this part here. We have here a nonlinear amplifying loop mirror with the gain medium and, of course, the optical care effect. And if one wants to understand how the Setcher absorber mechanism in this laser, one has to follow the pulse through the cavity and look at the polarization, what happens to the polarization. We can start with by acknowledging that the polarization beam splitter each round trip resets the polarization to a linear state, which is then propagating through a so-called non-reciprocal phase bias, where one can tune the wave plates to alter the polarization state of the electromagnetic field into some sort of elliptical polarized light, which is then separated at the second PBS into a clockwise and counterclockwise propagating pulse, which then enters the fiber loop and accumulates the nonlinear phase via the optical care effect. Here again, the fiber part is constructed of this polarization-maintaining fiber loops, hence the polarization, the linear polarization, will be maintained through propagation. And now, due to this asymmetry with respect to the gain medium, one of the pulses will be amplified at an earlier stage than the other one, and both pulses accumulate a differential nonlinear phase shift before they recombine due to the same optical pathway and travel in the direction of the PBS again. So now the question is, how does the transmission at PBS looks like? And for this one, has to make oneself clear that the differential nonlinear phase shift is actually resulting in a nonlinear polarization rotation of the field after recombination of the two counterpropagating pulses here. So one has a nonlinear modulated field E and L, which has a nonlinear phase difference, which can be estimated with this equation here. And now one can look at the recombined field and then think about what happens now at the transmission. So if we now look at the polarization rotation proportional to the nonlinear phase difference, one can, for example, tune the system in a way that one has maximum reflection at the PBS for small signal nonlinear phase differences. So at the low intensities, one would have all of the light would be rejected by the cavity or reflected out. For high intensity, however, the polarization state is rotated by the increasing nonlinear phase difference, resulting in an increasing transmission at the of this PBS, so the loss is decreased up to a certain maximum. So, for example, at the peak of the pulse, one then could achieve maximum transmission of the cavity, and this is exactly the dynamics which are required in order to shape a saturated absorber. And what we are asking now is, first of all, before I go into this, maybe I want to emphasize that this results in a kind of sinusoidal transmission function for the two output ports, the transmitted and reflected port. However, one can see if one calculates this cavity with the Jones formalism that without this phase bias, one starts at a slope of zero for small signal nonlinear phase difference and small signal fluctuations. However, in order to elevate a pulse, an optical pulse from CW noise, one actually would prefer to shift the curve to a point, in this case, from the dark blue to the light blue curve, where one has maximum changes in cavity transmission for small emerging pulses from the CW noise in order to reliably self-start the mode-locked, enter the mode-locked steady states. In addition, one can, by using these wave plates in the phase bias, one can tune the transmission characteristics of this cavity, as well as changing the energy splitting ratio between the two counterpropagating pulses, which enables really a high degree of tunability. This is the main advantage of this ladder system and can be used to really build new systems and use this tunability to tailor the system properties to the respective input. So now what we were asking during my master thesis is how is actually the intracavity noise or the intracavity fluctuations, how is this transferred by this mechanism or by this nonlinear transmission characteristics? And for this one can take assume a fluctuating intracavity power substituted in the equation for the nonlinear phase difference, which essentially couples the peak power fluctuations to the transmission curve or reflection curve of the laser system. And then we can assume, for example, an arbitrary example where we have a certain average peak power which corresponds to an average nonlinear phase difference which is settled on, for example, in this case, the positive slope of the transmission curve. So what happens now, if we now look at the fluctuation, a peak power fluctuation, it is translated to a nonlinear phase difference fluctuation, which in return, in this case, increases the transmission of the field. So the peak power fluctuations is actually amplified via these phase fluctuations, which result in changes of the transmission. Simultaneously, at the other output port, we have the opposite case. So here, the transmission is reduced for overshooting intensity. So one has kind of a self-healing, noise-suppressing effect in this case. So in this case, we would have noise enhancement at one port and noise suppression at the other port. If you look at the other case where we have the negative transmission slope at the transmitted output, which is essentially the part which remains in the laser cavity, then for an oversaturated working point, one would then obtain noise suppression for the intracavity field and noise amplification for the rejected field. And what we have shown is that actually in these types of lasers, so they are, as I said, really they achieve constantly state-of-the-art noise performance without a real explanation. And what we have shown is that actually those lasers, they naturally stabilize on such a working point which oversaturates the transmission, which gives them essentially which enables mode-locked steady states with intrinsic intensity noise suppression. This can be seen, initial point to show this was that there's for broad range of working points a characteristic difference in the amplitude noise. And then we compared the mode-locked laser itself with the reference system and demonstrated this mode-locked steady states with intrinsic noise suppression, which is then also, as has been shown recently, correlated with intrinsic suppression of phase noise and timing jitter, making these lasers ideal candidates for future low-noise applications. In addition, we now have a nonlinear mechanism which is able to really suppress the intensity noise. And now one can go ahead and develop, for example, a system which actually constantly operates in such a working point where one has this noise suppression. And this is what we did as the next step. Here we can see the schematic of such system. We have, first of all, commercial mode-lock laser source, operating at 1030 nanometer, 50 megahertz. Then we have a port TNR separation module, which corresponds each port to one of those inverse transmission and reflection curves. And we have again the phase bias module as well as a nonlinear interferometric fiber amplifier. In this case, we don't have counterpropagating pulses in the fiber loop, but instead co-propagating polarization modes in this fiber, which then accumulates a nonlinear phase difference, resulting in the nonlinear transmission interaction once the pulse completes one round trip and is then separated at port T and port R. So the goal was to really operate the system in a constant, in a working point which is on the utmost negative slope, resulting in a most efficient noise suppression. And this approach is based on the fact that the system is so highly tunable. So one can really, as one we have shown in this simulation, one can really, for arbitrary gain factors in the fiber amplifier, find working points for the phase bias settings, the rotation angles in the phase bias, where the noise is, reaches the maximum. In this case, this simulation shows the noise transfer coefficient, which basically relates the noise at the output, the relative intensity noise at the output to the input. And one can see here that for certain waveplate rotation angles, this noise transfer coefficient goes to zero, which means in theory, all of the noise at the input is not present anymore at the output with simultaneous signal amplification. Of course, then, since the transmission and reflection curve are always inverted, one has then exactly the opposite case for the reflective port. And now, what we've shown is, we constructed such system and measured actually, for example, in this case, this noise transfer coefficient at the transmitted port of the system as function of the pump power in the fiber amplifier. And one can see here, especially interesting, in this case would of course be a working point where we have lowest noise, output noise, so highest noise suppression with simultaneously high optical gain. And one can see actually that at this point the laser reaches standard quantum limit or short noise limited noise operation at high frequencies with more than 20 dB active noise suppression while simultaneously amplifying the signal by 13.5 dB. So that one now has a device which can actually suppress the noise by such an amount and simultaneously amplifies. This is extremely interesting, of course, for applications. For example, if one has long fiber amplifier chains, which typically increase the noise, and then one can put such a device at the end as the last amplifier stage and get rid of all the previously accumulated noise to then make this laser system feasible for low noise applications. So right now we're doing exactly this. We basically now have a nice toolbox with to build ultra-low noise oscillators at the one hand and then further amplify and compress this already low noise. And we now try to apply this also in the context of my PhD to build really ultra-low noise sources for nonlinear microscopy in collaboration with some biologists on the DESY where we look at protein crystals. And yeah, with that, I want to thank you for your attention and thank you very much again for giving me this opportunity to speak here today.